So welcome, everyone. I hope you've had a great day. Please feel free to move a little bit closer. It feels like there's a lot of critical mass towards the back of the room. We won't think it's rude if you get up and move down a little bit. So welcome to our last panel, which we feel is one of the most important of our whole week, because we've been laying out all the challenges of a very rapidly changing and complex world for the last 3 days. And now is our chance to figure out how do this very important association of funders think about the challenges in the world, and how do their strategies and their strategies for impact in the world dovetail with the theories of change and the strategies that we, as program implementers, have in the world. And so I want, if you haven't read it already, I highly recommend the Peace and Security Funding Index that Rachel will be talking about, because it sets forth a fascinating taxonomy of funding strategies, and then is a treasure trove of information about which foundations are making which kinds of grants in what dollar amounts. And you can click, it's just very, very interactive. So please read it. I think it's fascinating and will be the basis for our discussion today. So the way the panel will work is that Rachel LaForgia, who's the program director for the Peace and Security Funders Group, will give a 15-minute overview of the Peace and Security Funding Index, so you have a good sense of some of the major lessons emerging from that. And then we have two funders and Alex Toma, who is the executive director of the Peace and Security Funders Group, and we'll talk more about some strategies in the grant-making world and how we think together about making an impact in these big social problems. So the rest of our panelists, we have Steve Del Rosso, who is the director of the International Peace and Security Program at the Carnegie Corporation of New York, Mary Stata, who is an investments manager at Humanity United, and Mary, if you want to continue over a little bit from the last panel and talk about systems work, we can do that too, and Alexandra Toma, who is the executive director of the Peace and Security Funders Group. So welcome, all of you. We'll leave plenty of time for a discussion with our full group, but Rachel's going to start us off.
Thanks, Melanie. Looks like we have no signal, but
oh dear.
Maybe it'll...
Okay.
Oh, there we go.
Signal's found.
So thank you all for making it to the end of this conference. I know 4 o'clock on the Thursday before Memorial Day weekend is a tough time to sell, so I will try to keep you engaged and not bore you with this presentation. I'm gonna go over the index, what it is, some of our key findings, the peace building specific findings, and how you can use it, and then take a couple of clarifying questions before we go into the panel. So what is the index? I see a lot of you have phones, laptops, they have great internet here. So feel free to go on the website, I'll show you the site shortly. But the index is essentially a mapping of 288 foundations' grants. So there's 2,000 grants. In 2013, foundations gave $283 million in grants to peace and security work. Writ large, so not just peace building, all types of work. And so that's represented on the index, and there is a website. Again, I invite you to go to it now. It's peaceandsecurityindex.org. Obviously, we love short URLs. And then also there's a report which you can download from the website, to be totally honest. Sorry, Alex. The website is way more exciting than the report because you can click it, but you can feel free to look at both. So basically what we did was we wanted to undertake this mapping to understand who peace and security funders are, what they do, and what they're funding. And the reasons why for us were A, to understand for our members who are all foundations, you know, who their partners are. Are there new partners we don't know about? How can we get people to work together more? And for civil society organizations, NGOs, grantees, to be able to identify new partners, to see how their work fits into this broader picture, to find, again, new funders, new partners, and really just to shed more light and transparency onto this sector. So this is our framework that Melanie mentioned, based on a group of advisors who helped us come up with this framework, as well as the grants themselves. We found that peace and security funders do three things through their grant making. They aim to prevent and mitigate conflict, resolve conflicts, and build stable, resilient, peaceful societies. And they do this throughout the spectrum of conflict and peace. And so one of the top questions we get is, you know, why is it a line? Why isn't it a circle? We talk often about how conflicts are cyclical. And so that was actually a strategic communications decision. Part of the reason why how we want to use this index is to bring new funders to the table, to bring more money to the pot. And so when we're trying to sell this work to people, you know, we don't want to sell them a circle of doom. We want to send them a message of hope. So we have kind of this hopeful rainbow that hopefully illustrates, you know, the goal that you can make progress in this field, that you can put money into things, you can support great work and have really great important outcomes. So again, we hope that we will attract more funding to this field. So the website again is laid out, and there's different issue areas that you can look at. Peace building is one of them, and you can kind of see the pool of funding. This is an example for those of you who don't have internet access right now of what you'll see on the website. This is funding for resolution period of conflict, and you'll see that there's peace building, peace negotiations, and DDR as a subset of that. So you can see kind of the funding breakdown. On the website, you can also see the funding breakdown geographically, and it cross-sects the data. So you can look at the data in different ways and look at really countless options of how the funding is divided. You could spend days on the site if you really wanted to. Key findings. So we had 5 key findings overall. So I'm gonna give you those first and then kind of situate the peace building findings within that. First, peace and security funding is a small piece of the pie. I've heard this countless times over the past couple days, whether it's government funding or civil society organizations talking about how the pie is so small for this field and this space. And that's true within the foundation world. So peace and security funding makes up less than 1% of total foundation giving. So we're talking about a small pool within the overall pie. Despite that, the funding is having really outsized impact. And on the website, you'll find stories of some of updates of progress in some of the grants, the work that many of you are doing, in fact. And what we wanted to come through on the site is really to convey a message that it's not about money, it's not about dollars and grants and numbers, it's really at the end of the day about people. And it's not just numbers, it's not numeric, there's stories behind all of these grants, all of this funding. And so you'll find some of the spotlight stories on the website, and that's something we really wanted to bring out. So there is impact happening with really small amounts of money, again, which I'm sure most of you know. Diversity. The funding field is really diverse, both in terms of issues funded and in terms of types of funders. So it's not like every foundation in this field is making huge grants of $200,000 a year. We have foundations who are making, you know, $1,000 grants all the way through the 1 point or 2 point whatever million dollar grants. So there's a really wide range, and that's positive because if you're a smaller organization, it means you have access to small grants that you can spend. And if you're a larger organization, you also have access to larger grants. There's also diversity in areas of focus. Again, on the website, you'll see there's, I think, 30 different areas that you can track how much funding goes to. So there's a wide range of areas of interest. Funders support a wide range of strategies. You'll notice that general support made up 20% of the grants. And so that's something that we as the Peace and Security Funders Group are gonna be working with our members to hopefully improve, knowing that, again, over the past few days, we've heard how important general operating support grants are, and that's something we're gonna work with our members to hopefully increase in the future. But you can see the other strategies again on the website. Prevention. Grant money for conflict prevention and also atrocities prevention is a really small, really underrepresented area. And again, this was referenced yesterday during yesterday's keynote on the challenges of funding and getting funding for prevention work. And so it made up only 6% of overall funding, which was something that I don't know if that we were surprised by, but we thought it was important to highlight given, you know, a lot of the attention recently that's been coming to atrocity prevention and response. And finally, just a reminder, this is a mapping of grants and grants data. So it's not a mapping of the field itself, it's a mapping of how foundations are making grants within this field. And so one of our findings is that we really need to improve the data set and the information we get from foundations so that we can better map the funding. And so here's 2 examples of grants that we have in our set. Both are for general support, but as you can see, the level of description is very different. And what that means for us is when we get a grant like the first one that just says for general support, we have no way of knowing if it's a peace building grant, if it's a prevention grant, if it's a reconciliation grant, we don't know. And so one of the things that we're doing on our end is working with our funders and other foundations to improve the quality of data submissions so that we can have a better sense of what they're actually funding. peacebuilding funding. So in 2013, and this is all again based on 2013 data, the reason for that is A, this is the first year of the project, and so that's the data we had to work with. We're working on updating it and making it more current. There's always gonna be a year lag time. We'll always be looking at the previous year simply because of the way foundations report data and the time it takes to process the data. So we are looking at 2013. 9.8 million in grant making went to peace building in that year. There was 131 grants, and it represented 3.5% of total funding. Again, it's a very small amount within a small pie, so we're talking like, you know, the Weight Watchers piece of pie, not your like Thanksgiving pie. Yeah. And 38 foundations did make those grants, so there are a considerable number of funders who are funding peacebuilding work. Also, we know that there may be other peacebuilding funders out there who aren't represented on this yet. And so if you know of any funders, and I'm gonna show you the list next, shortly I'll show you the list, but if you see someone that's not represented, please come find me, because I would love to reach out to them to ensure their data is in our index. So peacebuilding keywords. This is the words that we used to identify peacebuilding grants. And this gets into more of the technical database side of things, which is really fun. I can tell you. but basically, these are the key words we used. So if a grantee or grant description had any of these words, it pulled into the peacebuilding set of grants. Now, I'm sure some of you are out there like, well, what about mediation? What about reconciliation? So that was a really big challenge for us, is how do you define peacebuilding work? Everyone defines it differently, and what words are people using and not using to describe their work? And so that again was another challenge in this, was trying to figure out how we pull in relevant grants and exclude the ones that aren't really peace building. So we wound up with all of these words through, again, feedback from our advisors, and also by looking at the grants themselves and doing some research on the grantees and the work they were doing. So it was a pretty comprehensive process. But again, if anyone sees a word and you're like, well, I don't know if peace building should have a hyphen or not, I'm happy to discuss that with you after. And here are just three sample grants I wanted to show you. So there are sample grants found throughout the website, but these are three peace building specific ones with all of the variations in spelling. And I wanted to show you because it really shows the breadth of the grants that are encompassed by peacebuilding. So you have an Alliance for Peacebuilding grant on peacebuilding evaluation, which is one type of grant. You also have a grant to a city council, which is definitely a non-traditional recipient on their peacebuilding work, and then a grant to a local org for peacemaking efforts, again, on a totally different lens. So this just really represents the diversity within the field of peacebuilding itself, the diversity in funding interests. So you have funders who are really interested in a wide range of geographic contexts, issues, and approaches. And then also, I didn't put the size on, but the sizes of the grants also vary. You have really small grants, as you saw before, it was like a $2,000 grant, and then you have really large grants as well. So there is a lot of diversity within the funding field. We had two main challenges to tracking peacebuilding grant making. First is terminology, which I spoke a little bit about, but I'll give you an example of a grant that we have here where it's kind of like, is it peacebuilding, is it not peacebuilding? We have this grant that just says, for building a culture of peace. So how many of you would consider that peacebuilding, culture of peace? How many would not consider it peacebuilding? All right, yeah, thank you, yeah. So we don't know. The point is we don't know, and we can't make that judgment call because, again, we're working in a database. So I can't tell the computer, okay, anything that says culture of peace is peace building, because there might be some grants who use that terminology that are not peace building at all, that are something different. So that, again, was one of the challenges that we had with tracking peace building funding. We also, all funders don't talk about their work as peace building, so people will say, we're supporting civil society work on the ground locally. And so we don't know it's peace building, but you know, it comes out of a peace building program. But we don't have the information, so we can't code it as such. So we're hoping that the funding for peacebuilding is actually a little bit higher, and that we'll see a change next year once we have more comprehensive grant data. The second problem, again, was just general support grants, which are terrific for organizations, but terrible for building a grant database. So I guess we're kind of lucky that 80% were not general support, but we will advocate for more of that, despite the challenges it poses to our work. And then the 2013 Peace Building Funders, so get your phones out quickly, you know. it was hard to fit them on one slide. So these are all the different groups that funded peace building work, and some of them actually were a little bit of a surprise because we had never encountered them before. And so we're working to do outreach to pull them into our group to help them connect again to other funders, and then also to encourage them to give more money. So these are, again, some of these may or may not be a surprise to you, but if there's anyone who you're like, oh my gosh, you know, my dad funds peace building and he's not on there. And then that's important. This is only a mapping of foundations. And so there are operating foundations are not included, and there are some operating foundations doing incredible, important work who are not represented. And then also individuals. There's so many individual philanthropists that are PSFG members who are doing work, and they're not represented on this either yet. But we are working on that for the future. So again, this is just foundations. And finally, using the index. So you're probably like, okay, we have this big website. Rachel, you spent a year of your life, you know, in a coffee place, like, you know, drudging away through these spreadsheets. Like, what am I gonna do with this? So here's what you can do with it. If you're a civil society organization, you can scope out new funders. We hope you use it for that. We hope you go on there, you know, find foundations, stalk people, get in touch with them, share your work with them. Situate your work within the funding landscape. Use it to make the case, you know, only this percent is used for peace building, and with this small grant we can do this, or with this large grant we can do this. Use it to back up your work and to support it. And then make the case for more funding, for why we need more funding, because we do. And then policymakers, find foundation partners. Foundations are open and interested in working with policymakers and government donors, and so PSFG is trying to help build bridges between different groups to try to leverage funding and make the funding go further. And then learn about peace and security issues if you're not familiar with them. And then finally, for funders, if you are a funder, find new funding partners. We hope that you'll, you know, see one of those foundations up there and reach out to them and talk about your work. Help your board understand where your funding fits in. So if you're making the case to a board on why they should maintain or increase a peace building portfolio, you can use this to make that case. Remember, you know, we're having the Weight Watchers pie. And finally, to identify funding gaps. So the cool thing about looking retroactively at 2013 is you can think about some of the things that were happening in 2013, some of the things that are happening now in peace and security, and say, ooh, did we make a mistake and not fund the right things? So, you know, for example, in 2013, there was not a whole lot of funding, private funding, going to Syria. So as a community, a funding community, we can reflect on that and hopefully learn from some of the things that we did or didn't fund. And finally, fill the gaps. So if there is a funding gap, see what your foundation or friends can do to fill it. So that's my 15 minutes of fame. So now I'll take any clarifying questions. So nothing too specific, but if there's something that was not clear about the index, the data, or anything, I'm happy to answer your questions, if anyone has any. Yeah. So the data was pulled from the Foundation Center's database. So the Foundation Center collects data from foundations, not just in the US, all over the world, although primarily they are from the US, and they also pull data from 990s. So if foundations don't like happily submit their data, they just go and search through 990s and then pull some data, which isn't that great, but they still have it. So that's where it comes from. It is from the Foundation Center. And largely it is self-submitted. Foundations do turn over their information, which is terrific. The 3.5 is a piece of the overall pie. So it is a part of that 283 million. It's a percentage of that. So it's like part of it. That's what it's in relationship to.
And Rachel, could you compare that to the number in the human rights funding? Because that was quite a figure, but I don't remember what that other figure was.
$2 billion. So human funding for human rights work is at around $2 billion. So it's considerably higher. Those lucky people, human rights. Yeah.
I think we're good. Thank you. That was such a clear, concise presentation. Thank you.
So I wonder if I could ask you, Alex, and those of you who are at the Peace and Security Funders Group meeting, since you just had your annual conference, what was the reaction from your community? And it might be helpful also to tell us who's in your community so we have a sense of what kinds of foundations are part of it.
Sure, yeah. So we just had our annual meeting a few weeks ago. So Rachel has had a chance to practice this. The reaction was, maybe you could speak to that more than I can, but the reaction was reflective. I mean, I think we had a really great annual meeting. We explored some of the gaps and some of what the data told us. And there are several PSFG members here. So, I'm happy to turn it over to them. I don't want to speak on their behalf. But who they are is we are up to 65 members. They are all sorts of funders and philanthropists, as Rachel mentioned. We have public, private, operating foundations, family foundations, as well as individual philanthropists that are part of the PSFG network. And we seem to be growing almost, I wouldn't say weekly, but definitely monthly. Even in the past year, we've got 10 new members that have joined the Peace and Security Funders Group because they want to collaborate with their peers to enhance the effectiveness of philanthropy in this field.
Great, thank you. Are there other funders with Mary or Andy or Steve, would you like to talk about your reactions when you first saw this report?
Go ahead.
completely agree with Alex. At the meeting that we had a few weeks ago in Portland, it was, I think, a moment of being able to look specifically for me at the very limited funding available for prevention. And I think, there's a lot to unpack behind that and why, some of the very logistical reasons that Rachel outlined, but I think there are also some broader programmatic reasons that account for that real small amount that ultimately goes to prevention, which is an area that Humanity United has really been exploring very deeply the past few years and is hoping to increase our funding and our support in that area.
Thank you.
Well, I wasn't at the last conference, PSFG conference, but I was present at the creation when PSFG was established. And from the very beginning, we've been looking for a database of what the field, as we define, has been doing. So I commend our colleagues. Do I hear my voice reverberating?
Oh, it's your tie, I think.
It's my tie.
It's an honor tie.
Okay. Well, anyway, so I think that I commend PSFG. I think the report, as Rachel has described, there was some practical and methodological challenges. And if you read the end of the report, it says something about how you're going to learn from this, and there are other more nuanced approaches as you go forward. So again, kudos.
And this gives you an amazing baseline. This is to clarify, you do this yearly, so you'll be able to update this.
So we are, we're going to improve it. It's an iterative product and database. I don't know, yeah.
Sorry. It was on his tie.
But I think
you
it's
put
fine.
It on my tie.
it's so okay. we're gonna do this annually. And as Rachel said, there are challenges, but we hope that it's more of a resource than it is a challenge to get this data.
And just from a thumbnail kind of sketch, because we have the luxury of being peace building, a nice kind of broad fuzzy umbrella. To what extent did you see the ratios between security and peace, and was it fine grained enough to really capture that?
Rachel could probably.
Yeah, I think the answer to that is that most funders don't speak about their work so much in terms of security, and the grants aren't labeled as such. Uh-huh. So I think there generally wasn't stronger security or peace. It was really just totally diffuse in terms of the different issues. So you'd see like nuclear disarmament or see some diplomacy, but really it was more issue-based than peace versus security-based.
Interesting. Well, there are two sets of questions I'd like to ask you to get us started, and then we'll open it up to the rest of the group. But I'm very interested in bridge building. How do we build bridges between traditional peace-building work and then organizations that are doing peace-building work in other sectors? So were you able to capture democracy groups or governance groups or human rights or climate? I mean, to what extent is that reflected in this index, And even if it's not, how are you kind of seeing this play out in your own grant making?
Well, for the grant makers.
Please.
Sure. I think that's it's a really tough question, because even though, while I think all these different sectors, whether it's human rights or governance or humanitarian or peace building, we're all working towards, you know, a peaceful and inclusive society, ideally, and yet we're still very siloed in our individual work. Mm-hmm. And I think all too often our individual efforts aren't actually adding up to some of these broader goals that we all have in mind. I think forums like the Alliance for Peacebuilding are actually a wonderful, you know, entry point for having some of these conversations. So is PSFG. And I think individual private donors also have a role to play in terms of incentivizing different sectors to be collaborating and to be brainstorming. Even within sectors, I mean, all too often, you know, policymakers are very disconnected from what academia is doing. I think that's also a role where private philanthropy can play a role in bringing together these various different actors to be sharing research and recommendations, and to really be working together towards this ultimate goal that we all are trying to see.
Well, that's a perfect segue. Steve, didn't you just get back from Denver looking at bridging that gap?
Yes, indeed I did. We have a focus at the Carnegie Corporation and the International Peace and Security Program that we like to think transcends all our work in bridging the academic research and policy gap, and certainly the work in peace building is relevant to that. On the bridge issue, unfortunately, as you know, I wasn't here the first 2 days of the conference, but in looking at the agenda, it seems to me that there are a lot of bridges that have been built and are being built. And I'm not really sure what traditional peace building means anymore. And when I looked at the survey, it was pretty evident that we have everything from nuclear security to gender issues. And as was suggested, it raises a question, what was left out? Not only somebody's father who has worked on peace building, it wasn't recorded, but it there are lots of activities that don't have that the P word in it that obviously some could make a plausible argument under a loose constructionist definition of peace building that are relevant. For example, at Carnegie, we've had a longstanding program in reforming higher education in a subset of sub-Saharan African countries. So you say, what's that to do with peace building? Well, if that is contributing to the health of the university, which is contributing to the health and well-being of society, then that could also be included.
Exactly. Well, one thing that I've noticed, and it was part of the planning of this conference for this year, is I have not in at least 3 years had the conversation of, is peace building a field? Because that was the conversation for so long. Are we a field, or are we just, you know, some,
field,
you know,
in the making is the way I put it.
Mm-hmm. But I think people are also comfortable with the fact that this is a very integrative field, and so that there is some border with these other fields that we can help, we can encompass.
I mean, the World Bank, just last year, we were at their FCV conference. Mm-hmm. So the World Bank just last year, you know, rejiggered their strategic goals and overlaid five, one of which is fragile conflict and violent states. Mm-hmm. The World Bank, it's a squarely development. And another one I think is gender-based issues. And so I think there's sort of this understanding that it's, you know, it isn't, okay, here's peace building, okay, here's, you know, development, here's, now I don't think we need to water it down. I don't know that we should be, you know, merging with the Environmental Grantmakers Association. But I think that there are some, there's a Venn diagram where they all kind of, we can help each other out across sectors and learn.
Yeah, I think the SDG process also brought this, you know, in a very central way, where we now actually do have a goal focused around peaceful and inclusive societies and governance. And it was in a highly political process that led to that. I mean, I know there was an intense amount of negotiating, and earlier on in the process, a lot of people saying this shouldn't be part of a development agenda, and that it was, you know, quite heated at moments. But ultimately, I think it speaks volumes to the fact that at that big of a forum, you actually have that as a central part of an entire development platform.
There's a kind of deja vu all over again sense to this for me. I started in philanthropy at the end of the Cold War, and in those days, a lot of us were talking about how the emergent problems in the world were inherently interdisciplinary, and therefore we needed to have interdisciplinary solutions. And one could argue 25 years later, that's even more the case. And, you know, and I think in terms of peace building, the fact that it is so expansive and integrative is, to use a cliche, both a challenge and an opportunity. It's an opportunity because it's inclusive and can reach out, but it's challenging, particularly for some funders, because it's difficult to get your arms around.
Well, I wonder, you know, we have a good sense, I think, within our community of what the advocacy looked like around Goal 16. And as we came up to the World Humanitarian Summit, Nancy told us this morning that peace and conflict prevention were very much in the center of those discussions. What did the philanthropy discussions look like during that advocacy period? Were you involved with advocacy? Were you thinking about your own programs, reading the tea leaves about how some of these new orientations would be shaping up?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, over the past couple of years, we've been developing a new initiative at Humanity United, which is completely focused around the prevention of deadly violence and responding to the risk of violence. And this was while the SDG process was being negotiated. And I mean, I think it really did speak to a desire, particularly post-2013 with the crises in South Sudan and Central African Republic, in which we really were caught off guard and, you know, did not have the tools or resources to respond early and to anticipate those crises. And so with the SDG process happening simultaneously, I think what it really did was animate and deepen our commitment to be working in this prevention field squarely, as well as I think a lot of excitement that we're not alone in this and that there's a huge amount of energy and a burgeoning community that we also want to be better linked to.
And at Carnegie, was that kind of on the radar, or were you kind of defining problems a little differently?
Well, let me put it this way. If you're directing a program on international peace and security and you're looking at the condition of the world as it is, that means either someone like me is either needed more than ever or needs to find different employment. So, but the challenge is that a lot of what we're doing was already relevant to the to the new goals, but you know, our view, we've tried over the years, as best as the specifics of the agenda has changed, to not succumb to the kind of institutional ADHD that that can lead us astray. So under certain rubrics, whether it's nuclear security or relations with China and Russia, a lot of these subset issues that were reflected in the new goals we're addressing, but not. We've kept our eye on these for a long time and how they've evolved.
And just to add that the Council on Foundations, one of our sister organizations, very, very broad, but they have a track right now that they're looking at the SDGs and how funders can play a role. They're starting to facilitate some conversations. And the European funders are actually pretty jazzed up about the SDGs. So I know the European Foundation Center is particularly looking at how funders relate to the SDGs.
So I wonder if we could talk for just a minute about some of the gaps that we saw in the index. One that was mentioned already was prevention. And I had just a couple of thoughts about that. The first was, in our fragility panel this morning, Sarah Cliff left us with a challenge of how do we have a better typology of violence prevention, conflict prevention, CVE, and atrocities prevention. And then I also had a conversation with Aaron at lunch this week when I asked him rather bluntly, well, what did he think about the fact that prevention was only 6% of this total? And Aaron, I don't know if you'd like to give me your answer, which I thought was actually very comforting.
Sure.
Aaron works for the Carnegie Corporation in New York, by the way.
Sorry about that.
My answer to the question on conflict prevention was that I think there are a lot of, it depends on how you code some of these programs that different foundations are working on. And then there's a lot of things that go into conflict prevention. Conflict doesn't come out of one thing. It's more bulbous than that. It comes from society, which anybody who's in the systems thinking earlier understands is quite complex. a butterfly flaps its wings in Brazil, you know. So kind of my summary of that comment would be that I think there's a lot of things that go into conflict prevention that wouldn't necessarily be quoted specifically as conflict prevention. And so if we were to change the way we coded it, we perhaps would get a larger number that we would say is focused on conflict prevention. But I also understand why you would code it in certain ways. So.
Well, maybe Rachel, I don't know if you want to say something.
Yeah, so I was actually talking to CSO this morning about that very thing. So
CSO?
The Conflict Stabilization Office of the State Department. So basically, the conflict prevention piece, we actually did it as a strategy as well, prevention efforts overall, and that also was only 6%. And it's a little bit broader and encapsulates a little bit more. It includes track two diplomacy, it includes work on mass atrocities and genocide, which actually is not so much preventative that we're seeing in the grants. It's actually more reactive. So it's working with survivors of atrocities, working with prosecutions, which again, there are those that make the argument that it is part of prevention. So you know, it's a circle, and where does it stop and where does it end, and where do you start and finish it? And so it is pretty broad. We did end up with a pretty broad definition of what constitutes prevention efforts. And even within that broad definition, it still is a pretty low number. And definitely there are some issues within the field itself on defining what is prevention and what isn't. But I think that this, what's represented in the index, definitely isn't as conservative as it could be. Oh. So the number, in fact, is probably a little bit higher than what it actually is if you kind of remove some of the things that some may not consider prevention, like, for example, prosecuting perpetrators 20 years later. So because those were a bunch of the grants. I think only four grants in 2013 went specifically to early warning systems, specifically. So it is a very, very small piece.
On the early warning, just some of us who were funding early warning 20 years ago, the argument then was, and I think now is still the same, that we know enough about early warning. It's what to do when we have the early warning. Mm-hmm. So, you know, maybe that prevention qua prevention as defined 20 years, as Aaron and others have described, has evolved. So.
Yeah, I think also the response language is a little bit different as well. So we didn't see like early, we used early response as a keyword as well, and it didn't yield a lot of, because most people don't talk about their program as early response, right? You talk about, you know, election monitoring or, you know, access to justice. So we did put in words like that to pull in those grants, because again, our first round of things, we had, you know, early warning, early response, and it was zero. We said, there's gotta be more than zero, and there was. We just had to dig a little deeper. So
I think just what this conversation just now, the past couple of minutes, is illustrating is that it's very complex, it's tough, as you all know all too well. And it, you know, one of our challenges was to make something that is so 3D, so tough, so evolving and dynamic into something that those not in this room, those that we need to convince to fund more, do more, get more active, that they can feel like they're part of it, they get it, they're like, oh, okay, I got it. This is what peace and security, this is what peace building is, this is how I can plug in. And so, you know, I think we did the best that we could. I'm not trying to be defensive about it, but it's gonna be hard, as you all know. And it's, you know, I think we're trying to, part of what we're trying to do is to make it so that, make it like, yeah, 3D thing into a 2D thing, so that it's a little bit more accessible to folks. And I don't know, I mean, maybe in a few years it'll look a little bit differently and we'll have different keywords. And that's, we really do want you to, I mean, we do say this, we're not just saying it, we really do want your input and your help. And we are gonna be forming another advisory committee, hopefully, right? Yeah, for this year. So, yeah.
What form of feedback would be most helpful? Email, is there a place to comment on the website?
My email address is on the website, so if you go to the Think Frequently Asked Questions about us, you can find it there, and I would love to get emails from people.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Yeah, really. No.
Before I open up to the floor, because I know many people have questions, I wonder if I could ask each of the four of you a question, which is, for next year's index, what would make you most happy to see included or changed in next year's index?
I know Rachel's answer.
Rachel, as you start.
So for me, we had our little spectrum of conflict, and right now that's how the grants are divided. So I'm hoping we're going to change that so that we're looking more in depth at the issues themselves. So next year, hopefully, you'll be able to look at peace building, see the funders, see more information about the grants themselves, see where those funders are working. So just more comprehensive and a better resource for people in the field and also foundations as well.
Thank you.
I think that when you get the comments from various foundations, and foundation offices are not usually shy about expressing their opinion whenever their work is displayed in a report, that next year's will be even more nuanced in terms of the categories, the coding, and that will make some foundations even happier.
I definitely agree with Steve's point. And I think it would also be wonderful to see how we can actually use the index over the course of the coming year to be generating greater resources for some of these very under-resourced gaps that we've already discussed.
So would part of that perhaps be working with our community? Could we be doing op-eds or other kinds of social media or outreach? So there's kind of this communication between the funding community and the grantee community about where priorities could be.
Yes, I do. Yes, please use this as the basis of, I mean, Rachel said it, how you can use it, you know, of op-eds, of drawing more attention to the field, helping us make it better. One thing that I, et cetera, et cetera, and we have plenty of ideas, so do get in touch. One thing that I would add that I think could make it better is, and we're trying, and you kind of got a preview of this at the annual meeting, is that it does not include operating foundations, it does not include individuals. This does not include bilateral or multilateral aid, which we know is a lot. So we're trying to work with our partners, the Foundation Center, to see if there's a way in which we can integrate that data and, again, make it a more comprehensive picture.
Yeah, that I'm empathetic with the challenge, and it seems to me the tension between defining the field, whatever we call it, too broadly and too narrowly. But many of us who have been involved in the debate over what it is think we have to move beyond the semantic argument. But by the same token, I've used this line in many contexts, and it occurred to me in peace building, the Molière character who discovered he'd been speaking prose all his life. There are many peace builders who might be surprised that they're doing peace building. But that's okay, but it does also raise the specter of diluting the object of analysis. So I don't have a brilliant idea on how to balance that, but I think that that's a living challenge with this kind of survey.
When you say diluting, do you mean it's not really peace building? Or do you mean in the sense that, you know, what we really should be looking at is capturing those stray electrons who actually are doing peace building and get them into the orbit?
Well, again, it's sadly, it gets down to a semantic argument. A Norwegian NGO on whose board I serve 2 weeks ago decided to drop the term peace building from their title. And the argument was that it's kind of passé and too narrow. And I was the only... I'm the only American on the board, and by the way, you in particular, Melanie, you'll be intrigued to know that the new term they came up with was conflict resolution.
Oh my God.
So, yes. So I very diplomatically, as the only gringo in the group, tried to explain that, you know, there had been a discussion about this a couple of decades ago, and that in fact, peace building is rather expansive, and everything you're trying to do. So at the end of the day, I shut up, and I figured out that what they were going to do was more important than what they called it. So, you know, if we look at it, if we can somehow delimit this universe so it isn't everything and nothing at the same time, I think we'll be okay.
So interesting. So you're not changing their programming. It was just the way it was being described. Okay. On that note, let's open up the floor for questions. And why don't we cluster a few at a time? We have mics and... going around.
John Rudy, Alliance for Peacebuilding in Elizabethtown College. We've heard this week the Institute of Economics and Peace, I believe, says violence costs $14 trillion for the globe every year. If we could have like half a percent of that, we'd have a pie so big we'd be obscenely obese. Can we connect, are you connecting the social impact bonds and the social enterprise in that database, and would that just, you know, if those kinds of things come online, as they come online, how is that going to change the nature of what this panel's discussion?
Great, thank you. Let's cluster a couple of questions. Beatrice?
Yeah, Jackie Wilson, very interesting presentation. My question is about the other, if I'm understanding the numbers correctly, 9% of the funding. So what is the other 90% going toward? Are there big categories? I haven't been on the website. And is the reason for the gap in peacebuilding funding because of challenges with monitoring, evaluation, and delivering or being able to demonstrate impact? Or is it some other reason that kind of builds on what this gentleman was asking?
Thank you. Beatrice, down here.
Hi, Beatrice Polini. My question, it doesn't have to do with delineating the field or the definition, but the remarks, Steve, you made about the agenda the past 2 days and the type of issues and the type of disciplines we have brought in. Neuroscience, but there are others too. One of the challenges, the big challenges, is that, as you know, because we've known each other for a long time, among many people here, I like to take risk, and I think the way we, he said yes, the way we, and it doesn't mean that we fail when we do that, but we try to push the envelope and try to understand better, try to find ways to do our job better. The problem is, how do we finance when we bring in other disciplines, when we do things that are unusual? There are countless of projects. Many people here could talk about the projects they've tried to do that were on the edge. And you cannot find, it's very difficult to find funding in the usual suspect, in your usual donors. Very difficult, for instance, in terms of neuroscience. In the neuroscience community, they have trouble finding money to work on that. So how do we, how we do resolve that? And sometimes we are lucky to have people like USIP taking the first risk, but you still have to raise more money if you want to do the work. So how do we do that? And we have people like Ina who are helping to push the envelope, but I think on a number of topics, we need to find a way to tap into new resources in order to take those risks, to risk to fail, to push the envelope of what we are doing and bring other disciplines and other people in our field.
So why don't we take these three, because they're such substantive questions. The first was on the remark of just the percentage of the 14 trillion, but are we also looking at some of the social impact bonds, social enterprise kinds of funding? From Jackie, where is the other 90% going, and is M&E still a barrier for our field for funding? And then the question around, how do you fund risk? Do you want to start, Alex? And take any or all?
Yeah, I'll just take the one of them, and I think Rachel has, you know, more of the data. She can answer that a bit. But at the PSFG annual meeting a few weeks ago, this is a panel that we specifically had, was on different types of investments and different types of social impact bonds and divesting, investing, things like that. I mean, it's not exactly what you're talking about, nor what the first gentleman asked about specifically, but I think there are conversations that are starting or continuing to happen. I've only been in the field 10 years now, so perhaps they, you know, maybe this is deja vu again, but there are new ways of thinking. I think, too, to that point, that maybe to answer a little bit your question, there's a surge in Silicon Valley philanthropists who do have experience, and if you're not failing 80% of the time, then you're doing something wrong. And I think that thinking is coming online now, and you're starting to see some new foundations popping up who have a much higher risk tolerance. And there's lots of reasons why, you know, the different types of risk tolerances, which my colleagues can talk about if they want. But I think it's not an easy answer, but I think there are some new players on the scene.
I mean, I think this point about failure is a really, really important one, and I think our community as a whole needs to get much better about talking about failure and about being honest about it, because, and donors absolutely, I think, have a really important role in encouraging more open and honest feedback about failure, because I understand that if, you know, you're talking to a donor about a project or an initiative that didn't turn out the way you thought it would, that can make you quite nervous about that perhaps jeopardizing future funding. And I think that's, you know, a concern that's, you know, not an irrational one on the part of grantees. And, you know, at HU, we talk about a lot about adopting a fail smart approach. And by that we mean, you know, if we are on this, you know, in the Silicon Valley more risky side of the philanthropy space, you know, if we're saying that we want to take risks and we want to be funding on the cutting edge, we need to be comfortable with the fact that some of the things we fund will not succeed. What's important, though, is understanding why it didn't succeed, and then how can that learning then inform future partnerships, as well as then how can we be pushing that learning out to other donors and other actors in this space?
My boss, the inevitable Vratan Gregorian, has written and talked about what he calls the illuminating failure. And at Carnegie, we understand the philosophy behind that, but it's difficult in practice. If I had enough illuminating failures, I probably wouldn't be here today. But let me say a couple of words about the new philanthropists and the old dinosaur philanthropists, because as you well know, after the financial crisis, there was this, obsession with, and I will say obsession, with strategic philanthropy. And what's happened in a number of philanthropies is that our guidelines have become more narrow. That's been the practical effect. So trying to be interdisciplinary, trying to be creative, recognizing, as we did 25 years ago, that these are inherently interdisciplinary problems, when the actual guidelines are written in a very narrow way, suggests great creativity needed on both the part of the grant writer and the grant officer. That's old philanthropy. In new philanthropy, I think there is a great opportunity. However, and I claim no real understanding of that sector of philanthropy, but it seems to me that the real challenge is explaining that promoting positive social change is a long-term undertaking. As we heard this morning in the World Development Report in 2011, generational, 20 years. And my sense is, from the handful of new philanthropists I've met, that there is perhaps even more impatience to see the fruits of their investments as they did in the private sector. So the discussion, Robert Sigliano's the way he termed it, you need to have a North Star and a Near Star. I think the Near Star is more easily addressed in the new philanthropic world. The North Star, which is really the important one, investing individuals and institutions over the long haul, will be the greater challenge. But I speak from a great foundation of ignorance on that subject.
And John Paul Lederach, in his remarks this week, talked about decades thinking. So you're not seeing a trend in foundations towards that kind of 10-year, 15-year support?
No.
just checking to see if there's some undercurrent.
Yeah. But I do think you see long-term commitment to the same goals and ideas. It's not like foundations are flipping every 3 to 5 years. They do have 20, 30-year strategies. The grant cycles may just be short within those 20-year, 30-year strategies, even if they are supporting.
Strategies or issue areas? Because I'm not sure what
issue areas and then
really
strategies
anymore.
Probably maybe some 5 to 10 years, depending. I think it's difficult to have a 20-year strategy in any context.
No, as Keynes said.
But just in regards to the other 99%,
So we are part of the 1%. That actually is, you can find some information on the Foundation Center website, but it's really in a variety of areas. Not every sector has done a mapping, so it's not really a beautiful pie that you can just look at and say, okay, education is 75%, healthcare is 20% or whatnot. So there is some information on their website, but we are definitely a very small piece of the pie. In terms of including social impact bonds and alternative forms of funding in the index, it is a challenge. The Foundation Center, unfortunately, is a little bit bound by their name. They do work with foundation data. And so even operating foundations, it's difficult. They support who essentially fund their own work. It's difficult to quantify sometimes the amount of money that is being poured into certain areas and kind of match the data with grants data. So we are working with them on it, and it's a long-term endeavor to get them to include different types of support and funding. And also, just to echo Alex, the individual donors and next-gen funders as well are a huge opportunity. And so I hope that you don't see this as, okay, there's only 38 funders, what are we gonna do now? Because there are so many new funders entering the scene and looking for things to fund and who have enormous amounts of money. And so we just need to tap into them and convince them to get on our boat and join our team, so.
We have time, I think, for two more really quick questions and then maybe an answer and a wrap up before we end our day. So yes.
Thank you so much. Hello? Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Joanne Lauder-Young-Kelly with Karuna Center for Peacebuilding. I live and work in Myanmar. So very challenging context and a lot of discussions in the last year about funding and funders. Those more cynical than I, who talk about the peace-building industrial complex. a lot of discussions around conflict sensitivity. And Peace Nexus did a report recently looking at South Sudan and Myanmar and donors and conflict sensitivity. They found that conflict sensitivity tends to get pushed down the chain to the implementers. And by the time you have an accepted proposal and a contract and a log frame, you're really caught between a rock and a hard spot to implement if conflict sensitivity wasn't part of the country strategy of the donor in the first place. So I'm curious to know your thoughts on that, if any of your organizations, if that's being discussed, if you've ever used a conflict sensitivity advisor, or just your thoughts about having that more at the strategic level than sort of pushed down the chain to the implementation level. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Bob Reed, woo, with Peace Through Action USA. For Rachel, could you comment on the amount of funding in for beneficiaries or United States? And also then to broaden to the other funders, what's kind of the discussion in your space around the absence of peace in the United States and the role of philanthropy in particularly your types in U.S. domestic peace building?
So would you like to start, Rachel, then we'll go down?
Sure. So there's actually, when we developed this, we realized there's actually two questions, right? It's recipients who are in the United States and working on issues within the United States, because we do have a lot of organizations that are doing U.S. policy advocacy versus organizations based in the U.S. that are doing work abroad. And so we tried to separate that out, and you'll see in the report there's a little discussion on that. And we did find that it's not an 80-20, it's less than that. So most organizations are, I think it's just above 50%, I can't remember the exact numbers, but are not. It's not all US-based organizations. There are a lot of, is a lot of funding going to other countries and other contexts. You can see it on the website. Peace building specifically in this iteration, you cannot see the breakdown of where the funding is going by region geographically, but you can see within the resolving space kind of how that funding is broken down. But it's really clear on the website, so I really encourage you to look on that on the website. It's beautifully represented.
On the conflict sensitivity question, in recent years, we haven't supported direct on the ground peace building. We have supported a lot of research that elicits and applies local knowledge, which is our mantra, particularly in Africa. And almost as a matter of course, and by the way, just to mention, we know that local voices and getting local insights has been around for a long time. We don't romanticize the local, we don't treat it as a monolith, but conflict sensitivity issues inevitably come up when people are writing who are living in conflict-affected regions. So it's been a sort of a knock-on effect of some of the work we've supported.
I mean, to the conflict sensitivity point, I'll use the example of our work in Burundi over the past year, where Humanity United has worked with a number of groups on the ground, as well as some international advocacy as well. And with our grant making in Burundi, we intentionally used or gave our grantees maximum flexibility to adapt their programs, particularly over the past year as the crisis has really unfolded. Some of the projects and ideas that we had over a year ago, by the end of the grant cycle, were pretty much irrelevant. And so the way that we did that was, you know, we set up monthly phone calls with our grantees that we did in lieu of them filling out a log frame. And use those as really real-time learning opportunities. And those conversations definitely fed into our subsequent grant making, but also made sure that we were up to speed on how things were changing on the ground and how our partners were adapting accordingly.
Yeah, and my sort of last message as we're running short on time is that, you know, the Peace and Security Funders Group exists because funders want to collaborate with one another and with partners. So Melanie and I have a very regular check-in. So we do plug in. We're trying to not just, you know, be over here and every funder sort of doing their own thing. We work regularly with USIP. In fact, we have Steve Riskin is a very close partner of the PSFG, and even within PSFG, I mean, there are two working groups that come to mind, the locally led peacebuilding working group, where funders are really trying to hear from those on the ground and share lessons, and then there's the conflict and atrocities prevention working group, where, again, there are bridges amongst the funders themselves, but then also between funders and the practitioners who are on the ground. So I think, I mean, what my sort of takeaway message for you all is that funders aren't just sitting in their offices being like, oh, yeah. Not that people are saying that that's what they're doing, but it's what they're, except for Steve. Steve's never in his office. He's always on the road, as is Mary. But I think that there's really someone who was with us for our annual meeting, who was not a funder, but was there in the capacity representing a funder, said that, you know, it's really, she pulled me aside and she said, it's really heartening that you're having these really tough conversations and that you do it with great intention and with great humility and with really just open minds and open hearts. And she's like, I didn't know that this happened, and it does every day, and this is why Rachel and I are employed. And so, you know, we do mean email us because we do want to engage. And so that's sort of what, and that's sort of like what I would like to close on, what I would like to know, to let all of you know as well.
Well, I want to thank all of you first for this tremendous resource. It was just incredibly rich, and seeing, I know the work that you put into it over the course of the year. So thank you for that, but also to thank all of you for your partnership. That just in the very truest sense of the word, I feel that you are engaging with us, you care about our values, and we really feel supported in the best possible way. So thank you for being with us today and for your candor and your insights. And it's time now for us to close our conference, and I'll say a few words, then Nancy Lindborg can have the final word. But every year at a Passover Seder, you say, next year in Jerusalem, I'd like to say next year to USIP and for all of us to come together again for another set of wonderful conversations and fellowship. So many people have come up to me over the last few days and said, I feel like I'm home. I feel like I can talk about these issues, that it's just a place of not only excitement, but also a bit of sanctuary. So I thank all of you for making that atmosphere possible and being with us. I want to thank all of our peace builders who came from around the world. That it just was very striking. To have your voices here. And I also want to thank all of our American colleagues for being very open about that peace building doesn't happen over there, but that we need a lot of it here at home.
I'd like also, if we could bring our AFP full-time staff here so we can give a group thank you for everyone who's worked so hard. So I don't know, is Sarah here? So thanks to all of you, Emily, Liz, Ursula. Bob, did you want to have a few words before we close?
Well, last week I attended a conference of Europe's leading academies of sciences, and I am here to tell you it was dull. This week, 155 speakers, which made us a lot of new friends, wonderful issues, evaluation, finance, youth, team building, storytelling, proposals to work on media, which I think we better take advantage of, systems. We launched a really important report on smart security, which is necessary for smart peace. And by golly, I hope one of these wonderful funders will help us with a marketing strategy for something that I think will have worldwide implications. The SDG 16, the neuroscience. This field is so dynamic, so cutting edge, it's just thrilling to be with you and to hear your stories and to hear your ideas and your work. So thank you very much. Bravo to you, and bravo to you and you.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you to you for making this day possible at USIP.
Well, I will just simply add my thanks to everybody who's here today. What a great day, and the close of three really fantastic days. I think a conversation that's happening at a time that is more important than ever. And it may in fact be iterative. I'm looking off stage here, where we're rediscovering truths that we knew or practices that we've known in the past, as Steve mentioned. But the time has never been more urgent. And we are seeing an important coalescence where the World Bank, as Alex was saying, held a fragility forum in which the overwhelming banner was no peace without development, no development without peace. So there's an important moment of coalescence here. The conversations that you all have had, I think, are critical for validating, for coalescing, for crystallizing things that we're all thinking and doing. We are delighted here at USIP to be able to have this event here for the fifth year of partnership. Alliance for Peacebuilding is an incredibly important partner for USIP, and it encompasses this extraordinary membership that you have. So I want just to once again thank everybody for being here at USIP today. Thank you to Robert Berg for your wonderful leadership and energy. And please join me in once again giving it up for Melanie, who has been a stalwart in this field for so long.